today. Is it time to tax red meat for the sake of the planet? Not to mention thousands of lives. And is it exploitation to get prisoners to make remembrance poppies for just £10 a week wages? Maybe we shouldn't pay them at all. With me, Jeremy Vine. I'm just sorry, that was unusual. Good morning, welcome to the show. You know where you are, Anton, do you? Wednesday the 7th of November, joining me in the studio this morning, we have the Strictly Super God, Anton Dubec. Yeah. Yeah. Seriously. Thank you. Writer Nikki Hodgson and columnist Nikki. And the columnist and campaigner Martin Daubney. Our panel. My hands are clean, Storm. Ooh, okay, incredible. No, they are. Totally. Right. Okay. We'll chat in just a moment. Firstly, let me tell you what is on today's show. And we are going to begin by asking whether it is time to slap a big tax on meat, raw and processed, to save an estimated 6,000 lives a year. Oxford University scientists say we should. If we ate less red meat, it would cut global warming and reduce cancers. But what if we just love the taste? And then the prisoners who make remembrance poppies for just £10 a week. Charities say veterans didn't die, so prisoners could be used in this way. Others argue it's helping to rehabilitate offenders. Is a tenner a week enough? Maybe you think, if you're in jail, you don't deserve a wage at all. After that, has feminism unwittingly given men a leg up? This is really interesting. A new study saying that while greater awareness of inequality has helped women get better jobs and better pay, it's also made men fight harder, which is wiping out the gains by women. If that's true, does it need stopping? And then it's our news review, including claims new sex education plans aren't fit for purpose. And have you got any idea what this is? Have a look. Might look like a big rock. It could be much, much more. Storm.
I think other people have got other suggestions on what that could be. Good morning to you all at home. If you want to get involved and speak to Jeremy, then give us a call. That number is 0207 862 2222. That's 0207 862 2222. Calls from landlines may cost up to 13 pence per minute, plus any call setup fees, and calls from mobiles may cost considerably more. To send us a message, just head to Facebook or Twitter and search for Jeremy Vine on 5, or email jeremyvine@channel5.com. You could also text us. Just put Vine followed by your comment and send that to 85525. Text will cost 25 pence plus your standard network charge, but not all of them will make it on screen.
Thank you, Storm. So one of the founding fathers of Strictly Come Dancing, Anton, is with us. He's been a pro on the show since the very first series in 2004. He's one of the most successful TV shows in the history of BBC, and this man has been at the centre. He's partnered such dance floor legends as Judy Murray, Katie Durham, Anne Widdecombe and Leslie Garrett, and we'll have a word on this year's Strictly in a moment. But it's actually not your dance shoes that have brought you here, is it? It's the fountain pen.
And it's exactly what I used as well, a fountain pen.
So here is the book that Anton has written. It's called One Enchanted Evening. There are so many potential spoilers.
Don't put it flat,
I
can't see.
I need to be careful. Oh, to even tilt it a bit more.
Tilt it a bit more. That's gorge.
Can I? It's funny enough that the central character in a way is a hotel, isn't it?
Yes.
So tell us about that.
Well, the whole story is set basically. It's set in 1936. It's set in a big hotel in London. There's a beautiful ballroom. There's a wonderful band. There's an intrepid hero. And
what's the name of?
His name is Raymond de Guise.
Raymond de Guise. And would that by any chance be based on any person that you know, Anton
no.
Dubec?
Not at all. But the story really is, I describe it as a story of my life, in as much as it's not autobiographical at all, but it's basically everybody I've ever met, these wonderful characters I've heard spoken about by my old teachers. The ballroom is a ballroom I've danced in 1,000 times around the world. The band, the Archie Adams Band, is a band that I've danced in front of many times. The hotel is a hotel that I've danced in thousands of times. And it, as I say, it's set in 1936, so there's an element of the upstairs and downstairs about it. It's set at a time which is fascinating. I think the first part of the last century, I thought, was a fascinating time. So much happened and the world changed so dramatically.
Yeah, because it's a very serious... I'm not going to do any spoilers, but I note that on page 209, something big happens, OK? And I'm not going to say any more about it than that, but a lot of the book is about people not being who they seem to be. And then I think to myself, oh, is that in a funny way about your life? You know, the dancing, but at the same time, you know, you started as a baker with a different name, and dancing's all about the show, isn't it?
Well, you know, when one performs, I think, in front of an audience, you tend to put out a... You start off, maybe, by putting out a part of you that you want people to see mostly first, and the bit behind that you sort of keep to yourself sometimes.
Do you think you're very private?
I think I'm quite a private person. Yeah. I think I'm also... I love being in front of an audience, and I'm one who wants to entertain people, and I want nothing more than people to have a nice time when I'm doing something in front of them, when I'm performing, when I'm dancing, singing, whatever I'm doing, just sitting here. I hope more than anything else that the people in the audience here have a lovely time. And I don't know what that is about me that makes me feel like that.
When you said that, I thought so much of Bruce Forsyth. I thought it's the same gene. I've always thought you two very similar, because that's all Bruce ever wanted, wasn't it? Let's have a good time here.
Let's have a great time, because it's called entertainment for a reason. And I've never been somebody who's been bothered by the audience I can't see. So people go, oh, it's 11 million viewers. Obviously, not for this show, but only because it's so early. No other reason. But for Strictly, you've got 11 million, 12 million viewers for Strictly, and I'm never bothered by that. People say, oh, don't you get nervous? I said, well, I don't really, because I can't see them. I'm more interested in the people in the room.
That's interesting.
And I'm always really, same when I'm on stage, and if I get, I'm like, I don't read reviews and I don't read any of that sort of stuff, because if I get a bad one, I'm mortified.
Oh, are you? You care.
Not because somebody might didn't like it, but if somebody didn't feel like I was doing a very good job, or not being real or truthful in my performance. And that, for me, is the most important thing. You know, it's really... I work very hard on what I do, because I can't bear the thought of shortchanging somebody who's come to see me.
And we had
that's very important to me.
We had Anne Widdecombe on yesterday. She did reveal that she'd be dancing with you at Christmas. So she was a bit worried it was a secret.
Yeah, she said.
So you don't have to worry about that. Well, let's just remind ourselves of Anne and Anton, one of the all-time great Strictly pairings. Oh, oh, Anton, this is amazing. She's waiting for what's
come
coming
on, come
next.
On. Come on. Go on, girl.
She did that hand thing there, and they're like, wait, I'm waiting.
That's one of my favourite steps of all time. Yeah. Mostly everybody gets a bit of that, whether they want it or not. It's called the chuck and slide.
Yeah.
And I get... and off she goes. And I love... And I said to Anne, I said, we've got an idea for it. And she went, oh, I'd love to do that. And I said, well, I'm not sure I can chuck you across the... No, no, you must. You must. And the great thing about Anne, she was so brilliant and game and fun, and she wanted to enjoy herself. And again, she wanted to entertain people. We sort of knew it wasn't going to be on the forward...
And she pointed out yesterday she's 73 now, so you've got to take a
bit
of extra
care
there.
Yeah, I'm not going to be chucking her quite as much.
We'll watch a bit of you and Susanna from this year.
Oh.
And... I know. Just talk about this, because there. But do you ever? Yeah, talk us through how you would decide to do that move, Anton.
Well, the first.
What was voted the bum of the year one year?
Rear
by
of the
way.
Year.
Rear
Come
of
on.
The year.
Well, thank you very much. When I'm dancing with someone like Susanna or someone like Anne, I think the most important thing is I try and choreograph to their strength. What's going to be the most interesting thing about them? And it's Susanna's personality. And what I don't want to do is make my partner feel really self-conscious, because you're so out there on your own, on the floor, in front of everybody. And so I it's very important that I give them a whole big thing going on, so they can sort of hide themselves in it and just be part of it. Now, I don't want to make Susanna do a generic samba, just a normal generic samba, because that won't be very entertaining for her, it won't be very entertaining for the audience, so we've got to build it around something. Now, after all that sort of opening gambit, we went into pure samba, but we'd sort of set the scene before that.
Do you watch it, Nikki, by the way? You love it?
I'm obsessed with dancing.
Really?
As a child, I danced and danced and danced and then got a weird complex about it, as you often do when you're a teenager. And then when I met my partner, he's a really amazing salsa dancer, so I started, and I took some secret lessons recently to improve and then surprised him that I did, you know, improved. Oh, my God, Strictly is like, my, it's the only reason I'm a journalist that one day I might get asked to do it.
Oh, wow.
Well, seriously.
It could happen.
Could happen.
I'm putting it out there, yeah. So you know. Yeah. Maybe not this year.
Well, we've always
wanted Storm to get on it.
I know. I want Anton to be my partner now. I watch those clips and I think, you know, I could do this.
Could you go?
It would be my pleasure.
I could do the, what is it, the slip
and... The chuck and slide.
The chuck and slide.
We could get some proper slide for you.
Well, you did one with Judy Murray.
Judy Murray's slide,
she went off the edge of the studio.
Yeah. Ended up in Robin Windsor's lap, if I remember.
Yeah, it was so funny. She started laughing. It was brilliant, honestly. Okay, right. Well, Storm, tell us about what we got on the show.
Okay, well, first up, we're asking, is it time to slap a tax on red and processed meat? People are not going to be happy about this. Victor says, good idea, after all the CO2 and methane from the production is greater than that of motor vehicles, and that's taxed heavily. But Martin tweets, I would prefer to die earlier rather than give up my luxuries. I mean, it would be helping the overpopulation of the planet. No need to thank me. I don't think any of us are going to be thanking Martin for that. But could you give up your red meat? Do pick up the phone and give us a call. We want to hear from you. Now, after that, is it exploitative to get prisoners to make remembrance poppies for just £10 a week? Janie thinks that they shouldn't be expected to... They shouldn't be expected to do this for £10. They should be happy to do it for nothing, she says. But Jerry thinks this is exploitation, however you dress it up, so not happy. Finally, interesting question this, has feminism unwittingly given men a leg up? Carol reckons... it's made men resentful of women, has it? Keep those messages coming in on Twitter or Facebook.
I did just glance down to my little table here. I thought, why have I got a steak there? I forgot. <I'm... laughs> So we will talk after the break about the time maybe to tax red and processed meat. It could save thousands of lives and save the NHS millions. But would it be punishing the poorest in our society, those who need the most help? 0207 862 2222 is the number you need. We're going to hear from the panel first.
According to Oxford University, how much would the cost of processed meat have to rise by to save 6,000 lives a year? Is it A, 19%, B, 49%, or C, 79%? Find out after the break. We asked, according to Oxford University, how much would the cost of processed meat have to rise by to save 6,000 lives a year? The answer is C, 79%.
That's a serious rise. That's what we're going to talk about. Welcome back. We're live on Channel 5 with Anton Dubek, Nikki Hodgson, Martin Daubney. We've been getting dance tips back during the break here, I have to tell you. We might return to that. Later we'll ask if you think prisoners should be paid to make remembrance poppies for just £10 a week. That's what they're getting. Charities say veterans didn't die, so prisoners' labour could be used like this. Maybe you're shocked to learn there's a minimum wage in prison at all. First, should we tax red meat, steaks and processed meat like burgers, sausages, mince, all that? By tax, I don't mean the odd extra pennies. We're talking about, as Storm was saying, a galumping great 10 or 20 or even 70 or 80% on some meat with the aim of stopping us eating as much as we do. Oxford University scientists say there is growing evidence supporting a tax. Not only is eating too much of the stuff linked to illnesses like heart disease, cancer and strokes, producing it has a huge impact on the environment. Cows, sorry for this, belch and break wind. That warms the planet up. Less meat equals better health. Happier planet. Sounds like a no-brainer, right? The study recommends putting up the price of red meat by 14%, so a steak costing £3.80 goes up to £4.20. Processed meat should go up by a whopping 79%. Mince and bacon would suddenly become delicacies. But shouldn't we be allowed to choose what we eat? What do you think, Martin?
OK, so I'd like to flip this on its head and say we should tax vegans. And I'll tell you why. Because this is an absolute nonsense. The 6,000 deaths per year, they don't live forever. They're not like Doctor Who. They just die of something else later in life, right? Or the £70 million saved isn't saved. Because if you look at the age that we die at now, we're getting older, and the longer we live, the more expensive we are to the NHS. Two-fifths of the NHS budgets goes on the over 65s. The best customers for the NHS, if we treat people as customers, are motorcyclists who drink and smoke and drink Red Bull and have burgers because they die younger. They cost less to maintain.
Not if they're severely injured and they have to have a lifetime of care.
That's a rarity. The most expensive customers are those who live for the longest. This is an ideologically opposed resistance to consuming meat, dressed up as taxation, which won't affect rich people. It will hammer the poor, and they won't change their habits anyway. They'll just be down a chicken shop eating more junk.
Do you see a case for it? Nikki, do you see a case for it?
I do, because my dad had a heart attack at 67, and that was because he ate so much red meat. And I wish I had more time with him, and I wish that he hadn't eaten as much. He was 67 years old when he died.
Right.
And it was a big factor. So, you know, from that point of view, I feel, well, yeah, obviously I would rather have more time with my dad. But I think what Martin's saying about vegans being taxed is actually not a terrible idea, because one of the biggest problems we've got globally is to do with soil erosion, and vegans are contributing to that issue. And, you know, a
How
lot
does
of
that
what,
work? Because I just thought they ate less bad stuff.
No, because, the soy, the way that soy is harvested and kind of other crops are grown is destroying the soil, and it's a massive problem for the planet.
I'm hoping you're going to come out as a vegan now, Anton, to balance this.
I don't know which way to turn, quite. It seems like it's all bad.
But would you put a tax on? Here we are, look, we've got a steak here. So if that doubled in price, most people would be less likely to buy it, and we know there's a bad effect of that steak on my body and the planet?
Well, don't eat it then. I mean, to be honest with you...
Personal choice.
Yeah, I because you can't make it expensive enough, that's the thing. I mean, it's people who really are very poor aren't going to be able to afford expensive red meat. But, you know, fast food is so cheap, and it's essentially all red meat, apart from chicken.
And that is the big... That's, I don't know if your dad was on the fast food, but
no,
that's...
he wasn't. I think he was a sort of post-war baby, and so was kind of...
It's a different generation.
It was a different generation, but was brought
up
very much with having to eat meat because you needed it for protein in this kind of...
Meat and free veg.
And he ate a lot of kind of, you know, processed things like salami and prosciutto and stuff like that, which I love, actually. I have a weak spot for that as well. But I think the awareness is completely necessary. But I have to say, though, I agree with Martin on the idea that it's a kind of trend for veganism that is pushing through this idea that meat has to be demonised.
But meat is bad, isn't it? Let's just think about it this way, right? Leave out the joy of eating it for a second.
This week it's bad.
The amount of farmland you need for a herd of cows is incredible. They then fart their way to oblivion, and the planet warms up. There's more global warming from cows than from air travel. Well, we should all go vegan, shouldn't we?
We shouldn't.
We should find something actually to dissipate the methane, because they have done with
matches.
With wild, well, matches. We all carry some in our pocket. But apparently, with lambs, for example, there's a wildflower that you can feed them that does something to absorb the methane so they don't produce as much. Presumably there's something organic that you can do with cows.
What we need is stop telling people what to eat, let them make choices, and if we're bothered about this, then put some money into education and teach kids how to cook at school.
But we don't let people make choices that hurt the planet. We've gone beyond that. I can't go and find an aerosol that'll go straight up and kill the ozone layer. I'm not allowed to do that anymore. And that's right that that's not my choice anymore.
And the ozone layer has repaired itself nearly.
It has, so we're told,
A few more years and it'll be
back to normal.
Fixed over.
Yeah. So if I said to you, say, let's say I saw you in a restaurant, Antonio, I think you probably eat meat.
Yes, I eat meat.
So, and you're about to tuck into that.
Yes.
And I say, Anton, leave that steak alone.
I'll say, because that cow... business, waiter.
I say that cow...
Get another fork.
It costs so much to produce, it costs the planet, and it's it makes you ill long term.
Right, then. I'd say thank you very much indeed, Jeremy. Lovely to see you, dude.
Yeah.
And give me the steak. Back to your job as a waiter.
Off you go.
Yeah, okay. No, so I wouldn't, no traction.
No,
yeah.
Because I'm not a fan of people telling other people what to do. I think educate people as to what to do for themselves, what the best way forward is, what the good things are to eat, what bad things are to eat, and then make your own decision. Because you've got to be able to make your own decision in life, because it's sort of your life. I get the thing about the planet. I'm not sure a farty tax is going to save the planet from the position it's in right now. I'm sure great big factories with smoke, all that sort of
stuff. That is true, yeah.
You know, I mean, there's...
Look, numbers on the screen in a second. 0207 862 2222 is our number. Do call us. Tell us what you think. See if you would dare to tell Anton not to eat a steak in a restaurant, because I certainly decided that I wouldn't do that. I would not have that conversation.
Don't tell me how to cook it. That gets on my nerves. The chef likes to cook this medium. I don't care. Yeah. He's not eating it.
Yeah. Meat-free Monday, anyone, yes or no?
I do that, yeah.
OK, you do that, right. How about you?
Well, because I eat so much
my missus is a veggie, and I don't mind veggie food, but I just don't like being told what I can eat.
Yeah.
OK, Storm.
Well, plenty of people are talking about this. The minute you talk about tax, lots of people get involved. So Damien tweets, I wouldn't mind paying extra for red meat. It's not a necessity, but it's delicious. But Vincent says, instead of increasing the price of unhealthier processed meat, subsidise the healthier options. Interesting. This would really prove that the government's concern is for our health and not just looking for an excuse to raise revenue. Mm. Joe tells us, I wish we could bring in a wood-burning stove tax. You know, something that would actually tax people with money to burn rather than your everyday normal person. Don't know who these everyday normal people are. What are everyday...
Yeah,
what is normal?
No.
What is normal?
No.
But Lucy then reckons people are blatantly not taking responsibility for the health of the planet in their entitled pursuit of old habits. Ooh, nice language. So something has to be done for the right thing to be achieved for the good of all. But could you give up meat? That is the big question. Would you be happy to pay more for meat? Do give us a call. Pick up that phone. The number is 0207 862 2222.
So your calls after our break. Should we tax red and processed meat? What if doing so could save not just lives, but also millions of pounds in healthcare costs? 0207 862 2222 is the number you need. And we're going to see you very shortly.
How much does the average family spend on meat in a year? Is it A, £494, B, £694, or C, £894? Find out after the break. Before the break, we asked, how much does the average family spend on meat in a year? The answer is C, £894.
We're pleased to say we've got Anton Dubek with us very soon before you go into rehearsals with Anne Widdecombe. Today?
Oh, yeah.
Is it
today.
Later? Oh,
Anne and I together again.
Okay, good meat lunch before that, okay? Nikki Hodgson, Martin Daubney with us as well. Later we'll be asking if £10 a week is a good salary for prisoners making poppies ahead of Remembrance Sunday. Plus, has feminism made men more competitive? Greater awareness of inequality may help women get better jobs. Apparently, men have found a fifth gear from somewhere. We don't know where. Now, our story on meat. It's over to you at home. Should we tax red meat, steaks and processed meat like burgers, sausages, mince, the whole lot? Slap a tax on. Not talking about pennies here, 70, 80% possibly. Now, we know what our panel think. We've heard from Anton and Nikki and Martin, but what about you at home, Storm?
First up, we've got Sophie from London.
Sophie, what do you think?
I think it's absolute nonsense. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, at the rate we're going, we're all going to be living to 950 and paying 90% of our wages in tax. we'll all be in old people's homes, you know, with a recycled cardboard crossword book talking about the good old days when we could have a bacon sandwich that didn't take half our salary.
Well, that sounds quite attractive to me, an old people's home with a crossword. But so seriously, though, if they doubled the price of mince, would you eat less of it?
No, I don't think I would, because I've got the income that I can, you know, choose. And I think instead of whacking a tax on something, why don't they actually educate us with the facts rather than the spin, so we can make an informed choice? Because this is going to affect the poor. And also, you know, no disrespect to the people they say are allegedly dying, and how they can absolutely prove that, I don't know. But it's like 100 people a week in a population of 70 million, or give or take, that are going to, you know, and a lot of them are going to be paying tax for something that's not going to kill them.
Yeah.
So where do you draw the line? I just, you know, it's just blatantly wrong. And what your panel haven't mentioned either is the meat industry, which, you know, this could kill a lot of jobs. Farmers are already struggling. You know, the impact, and I'm all for saving lives, but ultimately we've all got to die of something. And, you know, there is no point. And if we all live longer, as one of your panellists said, that's got to be paid for, and then the planet's going to be overpopulated.
Okay. Stay there, Sophie. We've got Leanne. I just want you to hear what Leanne says in Suffolk. Leanne, what do you think?
Hi there. I think it's a really good idea. I think that, well, from what I've learnt, 70% of all the top human illnesses are due to us eating animal proteins. So I think, and the fact that is the... it's the top cause of environmental destruction.
Right.
I just think that people, the government, need to do something about it.
Are you a vegan, Leanne?
I am indeed, yes.
Is it, we were just saying...
And my three young children.
Is there a perception that vegans tend to be miserable?
Well, every vegan I know are... just lovely and just compassionate people. We don't tell people what to eat, we just educate. I'm an activist myself, and I've never told anybody. If anything, it's the other way around. I'll be at dinner parties and just going about my own business. I might just say something like, oh, we've gone vegan, you know, because of health, environment, the animals. And it will be the other way, where people will say, oh, go on, Jan, you know, come on, have this bit of steak, or, you know, don't you miss it. And
the meat pushes.
Throw it in my face. So, yeah.
Okay, stay there, Leanne. But you're keen to have the meat tax to save the planet. Sophie, what about that?
Well, I don't think it will save the planet. And whilst that's people's choice, I think more education and maybe meat consumption could come down gradually. But I don't think a tax is the answer.
Right, Sophie.
And I think everything gets blamed on eating too much meat. And as I say, what are we going to do with the people that it saves? Because the population's going to be incredible all over the world.
Right, thank you very much, Sophie, Leanne. Good. That's what Martin was saying, that actually if we remove all the causes of death, mm-hmm. we're then going to have the biggest social care crisis we've ever imagined.
Yeah. Too many
got any
people.
More?
Yeah, we've got somebody who used to work in a slaughterhouse. We've got Steve calling from Salisbury.
Ah, Steve, did that put you off meat, killing all those cows?
No, it never did. Good morning to you and your panel.
Hi.
It never did. I went out there as a 17-year-old to Australia, and my first job I got was in the slaughter yards, and I ended up working on the killing floors, and it was done humanely, my eyes, since I had a very good country to work in, the abattoirs. Now, I came back to this country and carried on, and then I became a chef, and I've retired this year. I'm a meat eater. I don't think we should tax meat. I think I have a good balance of eating white meat as well as red meat. Last night I had steak.
That's not what people normally say is a balance. They say I eat some meat and then I have 5 days off meat.
Well, some people do that. I like my chicken and I like my meat. I eat it. I don't tell anybody else what to eat. But I do think in 6 months' time they'll find something else to say, well, this is bad for you, but meat isn't bad for you.
Did you not, Steve, when you were a chef and you're carving, you know, the steak, did you not remember the abattoir and you think about the way that life ended and you feel bad about it?
No, not at all, because it was my job. It was a job I did as a 17-year-old lad and right into my teen till I came back here. But, you know, as I said to you, I'm sure someone sits in an office somewhere and goes, oh, what shall we complain about today? Some professor somewhere.
Okay,
and
all
goes,
right. Steve,
we'll change this, you know what I mean?
That's probably our job, actually, yeah. Martin, well, you know, you sort of say what you're saying. Have you ever been to an abattoir?
Yeah, I've worked in pork pie factories. I've worked close hand with how meat's processed and killed. And I think actually that's part of the problem. As in, if we understand where our food comes from, we might be more relaxed about it.
If I saw how a pork pie was made, I would never eat another one.
Oh no, I love them.
But I love them. But I don't want to stop loving them. I don't want to know if it's sprayed off a cow's heel or something.
Yeah, well, or worse. Yeah.
Well,
or worse. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, sorry, Storm.
Delicious.
You're not a vegetarian, eh?
I am, yeah.
Oh, are you sorry? So we can't interest you in our...
I'll pass on that,
I didn't realise you were, but also you're not miserable the whole time.
Quite a reason. No, I'm not. I'm quite a cheery person, thanks for
She's
that. I'm also sandwiched between two other veggies and a vegan at the back. There's lots of us.
Oh, but you're not a vegan, crucially, Anton points out. That's the difference.
I'm not a vegan, no.
Okay.
On the phone, though, we've got Fiona from Lancashire, who doesn't think it's right we should be increasing the tax on meat.
So what do we do, Fiona?
Well, I think we've got to look at it across the board. The issue is, for me, we're all eating too much. OK, I don't think increasing taxes is going to sort it out. I think we need to get education out there because obesity...
You're talking about us. Obesity is interesting because they're beginning to think that maybe meat isn't the cause of that. The cause of that is refined carbohydrates and chiefly our addiction to sugar. So,
brilliant. Totally agree with you. I'm a nurse and I can tell you now it's to do with things like palm oil, which is causing more destruction and tearing down the rainforests. In all your processed food, which is causing obesity, it's the hidden additives.
Yeah.
So to move away from meat is wrong because it's pure, it's raw. That's what you need people to be eating. It's vegetables and meat.
Thank you, Fiona. Just on that, Nikki, with your dear father, you might be beginning to think, well, it wasn't the meat, because the health advice we're getting now is really changing on this.
Well... It might have been, but, you know, when I actually talked to the coroner, because he had a heart attack and I didn't know for a few days, unfortunately, and when they had to do an autopsy on him, and he had very furred arteries, and, you know, he was on... That was definitely the point, and the only thing I can put it down to was the amount of meat he ate, because what else would have caused that, you know?
OK. Later, has the drive to get more women into male-dominated jobs actually had the opposite effect, making men fight harder for roles traditionally considered theirs? But after this break, do you have a problem with prisoners making remembrance poppies for only £10 a week? Is that exploiting them? 0207 862 2222 is the number you need. We'll see you in a tick.
Where else do prisoners make remembrance poppies? Is it A, New Zealand, B, Australia, or C, Canada? Find out after the break. Before the break, we asked where else do prisoners make remembrance poppies? The answer is all three.
It's
a question.
Not a question if it's all three. And you became a vegetarian because of something that happened on a farm.
I did another programme where I spent a lot of time in a farm and I got a dog roughly the same time. And one day I was just simply watching a couple of calves in the field and I just had this thought, oh, that looks awfully like my dog. That looks like Boo. And now I can't separate meat from my dog, so I don't eat meat anymore.
Interesting.
So it's not been a challenge.
Okay. It's interesting hearing about that journey, yeah. Thanks for being with us this morning. Strictly Come Dancing legend Anton Dubek is with us. Author Nikki Hodgson and the most excellent Martin Daubney. Now, come back, all three of you. Let's just remind you what's coming up. So in a moment, the prisoners who make remembrance poppies for £10 a week, is that exploiting them? Some say, well, it helps them to find work in the outside world. Others say, no, you've got to pay them a decent wage. After that, is feminism making us is making men more ambitious? A new study reckons it is. Greater awareness that inequality has helped women get better jobs and more pay, but it's also made men fight harder, wiping out gains by women. Does that sound right to you? And if true, how do you stop it? Then we've got our news review, why private schools should be sharing their teachers with state schools. Plus, we'll be finding out what's made the list of words of the year, gammon. Gammon.
Don't get that. Anyway, we'll find out. It's because I'm vegetarian.
Sorry for the veggie reference, yeah.
If you want to get involved in any part of the show today and speak to Jeremy, give us a call. That number's 0207 862 2222. That's 0207 862 2222. Calls from landlines may cost up to 13 pence per minute, plus any call setup fees, and calls from mobiles may cost considerably more. To send us a message, all you need to do is head to Facebook or Twitter and search for Jeremy Vine on 5, or email jeremyvine@channel5.com. You could also text us, just put Vine followed by your comment and send that to 85525. Text will cost 25 pence plus your standard network charge, but remember, not all messages will make it on screen. However, Jeremy, remember we were talking yesterday about baby boomers and asking whether they were the real snowflakes? Well, it has been winding people up online ever since, so I've got a few messages for you.
We've got Mudgeridoo, which is an interesting name. I'm sure it's not their Christian name or given name. Says, I walk to get my shopping in all weathers. I made all meals. We didn't have a car. I saved £1,200 for a deposit to buy a house. How easy did we have it? Well, pretty easy if all you had to save up was £1,200 for a deposit. Anyway, sorry. Ian adds, I don't wish to sound like a Monty Python Yorkshireman, but my first place was a tiny studio flat, which the cat had to leave because there was no room to swing it. We do not suggest swinging cats. It took me 10 years to work my way up to a house. And Sue says, we scrimped and saved. Beans on toast was our main meal. I love beans on toast. Sat with hot water bottles on our laps. Sometimes we have to do that in the studio because it gets so cold. When we couldn't afford to put the fire on. Don't smack us in the face, Mr. V. Were you smacking people in the face? No,
well, I mean, we've certainly upset people by talking about baby boomers, for sure, and just how the golden generation. A lot of them certainly had to use outside toilets in the early days, and yet they didn't buy a flat screen TV until they could afford it. I did have someone say to me the other day, we fought in the war, but I was thinking, if you fought in the war, you were 10 when you parachuted into Arnhem. So that does not sound likely. So we need to stop that. Now, is it unkind to get prisoners to make remembrance poppies for just £10 a week? Inmates at HMP Ford Open Prison in West Sussex make the green plastic stems and black buttons for the poppies. And another prison, HMP Whitemore in Cambridgeshire, gets its inmates to refurbish poppy appeal, collecting tins and buckets. They're paid the prison minimum wage to do so, so that's £10 weekly. The prison service says there's good reason. It gives inmates a sense of what paid work is, and that helps them go straight when they finally get out. The charity War on Want disagree. They say it's exploitation. Prisoners should be paid a living wage. Veterans didn't die, so inmates could be used in this way. The Howard League for Penal Reform says the work won't help them get a job on release either. Anton, what do you think about this?
I'm staggered by it a bit, actually. I'm staggered a bit. I don't know if you can be. I don't think they should be paid. They don't have to pay any rent, so they don't need any money. I think they should do the make the poppies. I don't think it's exploitation. You're talking about inmates in prison who have been put there because they aren't very good at being in society. He tries to dance around this.
Well, they committed a crime.
They committed a crime.
Fact, yeah.
So they've been locked away. Now, do something nice. Give a little back. Make these things because they're important. And I think it's an important job for them to do. I mean, I don't know what to say about it, really. It's very difficult.
But you think basically you're in prison. It's like sewing mailbags.
Yeah.
I mean, what else are you going to do? You're in prison. Martin, what do you think of that?
OK, so I think it's really important that we understand how prison labour works. HMP Whitemore is a place I know well. I've been in there a few times, not as an inmate, but as a journalist. And the director of care, Naomi Murthy, is a good friend of mine. I spoke with her about this, because what I really don't like is the way that the media goes, oh, we're going soft on prisoners. What do we expect? Well, we chain them to the floor and torture them. This work, if we expect to pay prisoners a working wage that's paid on the outside, what do we think they might spend that money on? Probably things that aren't good. You'll immediately have loads of cash floating around inside a jail, and what's going to go on with that? Not good stuff. When you talk about rehabilitation or a sense of purpose, and I've met these prisoners, I've been in their cells, I've played in a prison band with them. I played Jailhouse Rock, funny enough. I've met these guys.
What instrument did you play?
Drums.
Right.
And they do this voluntarily, they do it willingly. And furthermore, when I spoke with Naomi, she said, a lot of these guys would do it for free because they believe in this. The poppy and what it represents. And I think that gives them a sense of hope and a sense of purpose. And those who are saying we should pay them more, it's slave labour, I think fundamentally do not understand how prison labour works.
But it's interesting that, Nikki, that charities have got stuck into this and they're quite upset about it. Well, because they feel it is exploiting them.
Well, they do, but the Howard League, you know, very much campaigns for this kind of thing. They're always going to come out this way. I also talked to some prison officers that I know off the record about this, and they said, actually, it's a very humane solution to a lot of prisoners' lives because what you're able to do in the morning is get up, have a job, have some routine, go and sit with your mates, drink some coffee while you're doing this, talk about what you're doing, which reconnects you to society because, you know, you're thinking about why you're doing it in the first place. They told me that lots of the prisoners choose to donate the money to the charity as well as use it for very basic things like some chocolate or a newspaper. That's what they get with the money. For people that have never been able to budget or maybe are in there for theft, it teaches them a relationship with money which they've never had before, for some of the younger ones. For the older ones that are maybe that have worked their whole lives, it gives them that sense of routine back. Maybe they're immobile and they're not able to do, you know, something more physical.
But it feels like if you're wanting to make poppies, you are getting the cheapest labour to do it, which seems a bit cynical.
I think you could get volunteers to do it. I think there's enough people in this country that would volunteer for free to make poppies. I don't think that's the issue. I think what it does is it gives this sense of reattachment to society back to the prisoners, and that in itself, for me, is a very humane thing to do. Mm.
Do you worry that it takes prison away from punishment, Anton? Is that one worry?
Again, I'm not massively informed on the whole prison system like Nikki and Martin. Yeah. I was going to say Michael, I apologise. Martin, of course. But I think I struggle to get the whole concept of being paid whilst you're in prison to do a job of making the poppies. A wage that is quite good in the context of...
Because it feels like it should be voluntary work.
Yes, absolutely. I think it's something that they should... Absolutely, yes. I think it's absolutely should be
voluntary. Because it could be relabeled in that way, Martin. Your friend, the prison governor, could say, look, we can't really pay for this. This is not the sort of thing you take money for. So if you want to do it, but we can't pay. This is the one job we can't pay for.
But it's an extra incentive to participate. I mean, again, I repeat, it's not compulsory. This is voluntary work. And, you know, what would happen if the Royal British Legion were not paying them? It'd be even worse for them. But they'd be damned if they do, damned if they don't.
Storm, what have you got?
Well, I've got a couple of messages before we got onto the phone. So Dee thinks that they should do it for nothing, give something back, seeing as we're supplying them with 3 meals a day, free utilities and a roof over their heads. Tough talk. But Linda tweets, they should get at least minimum wage or living wage. The money would be useful to help when they are released. Interesting, that one, to
save
that they would save
split.
It. First on the phones, though, we've got Jeannie calling from Fife.
Jeannie, you feel like Anton, you're not sure why they're being paid, is that right?
Exactly. I think they should not be paid. They're in prison because they've committed a crime. They should be giving back to society and not be being paid. I know hundreds of volunteers out here who are not being paid and have never committed a crime. And that's where I just can't... I think we're far too... just on criminals. This is all wrong.
What if, Jeannie...
are paid for making poppies of all the thing, too, for making poppies... where people gave up their lives to make us have a better country and life.
But what if I was in jail and they said to me, Jeremy, we want you to make some poppies, and I said, how much am I getting? And they said, nothing. And I then said, I'm not doing it then. Would you have me dragged out of my cell?
No, honestly, I would just leave you.
You'd leave
in
me.
Isolation.
In isolation. All right, Jeannie,
yes,
thank you.
Yes, you could be left. If you don't want to be doing any good, just leave you.
All right, Jeannie, thank you. That's tough. That's tough. Maybe that's what it needs.
Is it
Storm.
Tough?
Well, I don't know. Maybe it's not tough.
Well, that's what...
You know, as Jeannie said,
you
committed a crime.
Say, that's tough.
Yeah.
And you go, really? That's
no,
tough. Why
but
is
you're
tough?
Right, maybe it's
Explain
not.
Explain to me why it's tough.
No, I
you say that because I hear this a lot as a sort of standard phrase.
Yeah.
Because she disagrees with this. She takes this line of it and then you immediately go, tough.
That's tough.
That's tough.
I'm wrong to say that's tough. I feel it's tough because I've drifted slightly towards these two thinking they're going to come out at some point. Yeah. And if we brutalise them inside... lock me in isolation if I refuse to make poppies would be quite... Yeah. That would be in the newspapers. We certainly discussed that. But maybe it's not tough.
But a refusal to make the poppies?
Yeah, I'm not making poppies because I'm not being paid for it, right? And then they say, OK, in that case, we're going to punish you. That does feel a bit tough. But my views don't matter. Storm.
Yes, they do, Jeremy.
No,
don't
have any. I don't have any views.
Because you made a view.
So yeah, no, but you're right to pick me up on that. And I do think she was quite tough there, but you've made me think about it. Storm.
The isolation bit, I think, was the tough bit.
But you know, people are so sick of the classic, that all the attention goes to prisoners and none to the victims.
I mean,
I buy that totally.
It's very difficult to weigh this up in the thing. We have a criminal, and I mean, there are different crimes. I mean, there are different levels of crime. But you go criminal, and then you take the other side of the thing. Mm. It's very difficult to go, oh, well, all right, well, don't worry then.
Yeah. Storm.
Right, to the phones, and we've got someone that used to work in a prison. We've got Chanel calling from East London.
Chanel, now you're coming from the other side here. You want to pay them more.
Yes, I was actually a criminal first, and then I got a job working in prisons to help fellow citizens like myself. Now, the jobs they do is what pays for them to phone their families on the outside, because you've got families that can't afford to send them money on a weekly basis. So at the end of the day, this is the only money they've got to help them. And it also instills in them the ethics of work.
I hear
you. So the ones that actually work, when they come out, they're more inclined to continue working.
Right, but I'm just taking Anton's side here and saying prison's not about the criminal, it's about the person who was the victim. And
I understand that, but for people to be reformed, you have to install new ethics into them.
And what are you reformed
so
now, Chanel?
How do you expect Yes, I am, because I'm the one who then became a prison officer. I also worked in criminal justice and helped those on Class A drugs to better themselves.
Well,
so
that's
it worked
good.
For me, and I'm sure it can work for others that help this installation in them.
Yes, Anton?
No, listen, congratulations. Well, brilliant.
Good story.
That's a great story. I think they should work. I don't think prisons should charge you to phone your family either, by the way. I think they should have a wall of phones and say, use the phone. Have an allotted amount of time, whatever you need. But don't charge them to make a phone call. That's ridiculous. And also, you can still learn the ethics of work and routine and stuff, but you don't have to be paid.
Without the money, yeah. Nikki?
But if you've been in a situation where maybe you've never been paid for work, or you haven't worked, say younger prisoners, and you don't have that sense of, if I do this, I get this X amount for it, and then I can spend that on having a good life and not having to steal anymore. You know, it's about building that chain for some people.
That's that's education. I think they should invest more in education. Mm. Because that's vitally important. You've got to understand what you're trying to do here. Just because I suddenly have somebody who isn't used to this life, and because he's making poppies, I get £10 a week. Suddenly this is going to change my whole perspective on life without education. I'm not convinced.
Okay. Is it about retribution or rehabilitation? Where do we sit on that? That might depend on the individual in case, but having spent time in jails, I'd like to believe that everyone has a chance, a second chance. And I think treating people more humanely in that context, and the more time you spend in there, the more you believe that, weirdly, because it's like, what do? Chain them to the floor and treat them like animals?
Yeah. I
don't think that's option number two that's available to us, but I agree with you. Rehabilitation is vitally important because people don't stay in prison all their lives, and they do come out into society, and I think you have to come out a better person than you went in, otherwise there's no hope for you
in
society.
Our news review, go on.
I was just going to say, paying them £10 to make poppies, I don't think it's the answer.
Our news review is coming up shortly. All the big stories from the papers and online. But after the break, we'll find out what do you make of this new report which claims feminism is actually making boys more competitive. 0207 862 2222. Boys is the number you need. See you shortly.
According to the Office for National Statistics, the average female employee earns how much less than the average man? Is it A, 2.6, B, 6.6, or C, 8.6%? Find out after the break. Before the break, we asked, according to the Office for National Statistics, the average female employee earns how much less than the average man? The answer is C, 8.6%.
So here we are on Channel 5, hashtag Storm for Strictly, if you want to be in touch.
Storm for Anton.
How do we get that campaign going? What do we
I'll have a word with the upstairs, but just so you all know, upstairs, if you're watching the show, which you naturally will be, Storm and I would like to dance on Strictly Come Dancing next year together.
As a pair.
Yes! Okay, it's Anton, Nikki and Martin with us. Welcome back. Our news review coming up shortly. Everything from Donald Trump to alien aircraft on the agenda today, and we'll be finding out why That bear we showed you on Monday, desperately trying to be reunited with its mother, is making that journey. But first, has feminism unwittingly given men a leg up? This story is counterintuitive, it's strange, but let's just cling to this and have a listen. It has given men a leg up if we believe a new study from the London School of Economics. Greater awareness of inequality has helped women get better jobs and better pay. It's seen them move into roles in fields traditionally dominated by men, like law and accountancy. So far, so obvious, men aren't moving in the opposite direction into traditionally female jobs like nursing. But it's also made men more ambitious and competitive, and now they're just competing with women as well as with each other. So it's that kind of anything you can do, we can do better thing. So much so, the researchers say, it could end up stunting the progress that's been made in closing the gender pay gap. It may even make it wider. Young men in particular will fight so hard, we'll be back to square one. Is that true? The Chartered Institute for Personnel and Development would disagree. They say that whilst women are getting more jobs in fields dominated by men, they're not progressing to the top levels. A lack of flexible working means they just get stuck. But the report suggests that men are somehow finding a fifth gear to deal with the what they would regard as the challenges of this equality thing. Martin?
Yeah, I mean, I hate to sort of pop the argument about feminism, but this isn't about feminism, it's about competition. Quite simply, if you have a small number of workplace jobs, and women that used to go into teaching or nursing are now being encouraged, often at the public expense, you know, to go into STEM or law or wherever, and suddenly they're after the same jobs, what are the men supposed to do? Or just roll over and say, sure, take the job.
Well, they go back the theory
in the name
would
of equality,
be,
take my job.
Well,
no,
but the theory should be they go back the other way and they take the jobs in primary schools and in nursing and teaching, but they're not doing it.
Except there have been precisely zero government initiatives or drives to make that an encouraging thing to do. So what I'm saying is there's been no corresponding movement to encourage men into women's work as was tradition, whereas we've seen a one-way movement in terms of gender expectations, and so men are still where they originally were. And oftentimes, I hasten to add, for example, if you look at STEM science, there's research out which shows that you're more likely to get a job in science if you're a woman, because the trend is to hire women for those posts so they appear to be progressive. So men are having to fight harder to get on in those areas, and I think that's a good thing. It's good for business if the best people are working harder to get to the top. And I don't think this is a story about women losing out. It's about men becoming more competitive.
But, well, except that it seems that it may be stunting the equality agenda, Nikki.
Of course. Look, what we've had for centuries and certainly decades is men not picking up the slack when it comes to housework, childcare, caring for elderly people, disabled people. And what women have had to do...
Stop sweeping the,
well,
the streets
or finish my
be
sentence.
A bin man.
You know,
same at the bottom.
Let me just finish my sentence. You know, what women have had to do is make working arrangements that can accommodate careers earning money and caring for people. And what we haven't actually done with the whole jobs market yet is make all working flexible so that men have an opportunity to step up to the plate. But the other thing that we know is that when we give men the opportunity, they still don't do it because there's this innate drive... you know, for making as much money as possible, which is also a burden on men, I would say. And, you know, women are being educated to a better level. They're coming out with better exam results, for example, at university and at school. But one in four CEOs, business leaders are women. You know, three out of four are men.
Is that
men
sexism? Hire...
Or is How it... is it not? Men, you know, we still have a 8.9% pay gap. When the government did an audit in April and they asked businesses to come forward and say, you know, what the pay gap is in their organisations, that ranged from 10 to 80%.
Right. Yeah, it was a really interesting conversation that you and Anton had earlier just in the break, because you were just saying...
Well, hang on.
Let me just... Trust me here. So you just said, I love dancing, right?
I do, yeah.
And then you said... tell me if I misquote you. You said, you know, you go dancing with your boyfriend.
Yeah.
But you said... You used the words, I'm a confident young woman. And and something's changing with dancing now, right? Which is that the traditional way that the man leads, I'm guessing that maybe you're among many women who are not entirely comfortable with that. Is that right?
I mean, I've just always been, you know, forced to pave my own way. So I did find it difficult in partner dancing to be led. And I've had to have lessons to learn to be led, which I, you know, fine, fair enough.
What do you think of that, Anton?
Fascinating. how it
it relates to the conversation.
Well, because it's about our changing society, you see. I mean, it may be that being led around the floor by a man is not what happens.
The point is, women are pushing themselves forward, but they're still not being rewarded properly. You know, women that work full-time do 60% more housework than men. That's according to the Office of National Statistics, even when both of them are working the same amount of hours.
Because the partners are at work for 70 hours a week.
That's not true, Martin. People are doing equal hours of work.
You can't work 70 hours a week and then come and do the hoovering.
But there are loads of... What? But women are doing that. Women are often getting up in the morning, taking the kids to school, caring for an elderly parent and going to work.
More women also want to work flexi and part-time, particularly when they become mothers. That's a personal choice.
But I think lots of men would want to...
It's not sexism.
I think it is sexism because for centuries, women have been expected, if they're a good woman, what they do is care for other people.
But they may
and they put
to.
The care of other people first.
They may want to.
Some do, some don't.
I see.
And, and it isn't being thrown the other way.
Look at the diplomatic silence here. But you are in that, you're in the battle zone at home because you've got such young kids now. There's a lot of work to be done.
Yeah.
Would you care to help us on the split?
Absolutely not. I'd like to talk about my book some more if I could. it's a very interesting... conversation is because in my life, I can only take from my life, my life experience, has always been dominated by very, very strong women.
Right.
I've got very, very strong women running through my life. My mum, my wife, my mother-in-law, incredible women, all of them. But my teachers, I've incredible female dance teachers and coaches I've had through my life. Even in Strictly Come Dancing, for example, in the sort of chain of command there is fundamentally women. It's all women. A whole from the top all the
Darcy,
way down.
Darcy, Shirley, Claudia,
well, even going,
Tess.
But yes, fine.
Oh, like, Louise
I'm
and
going
all that, yeah.
through into the sort of production. And
yes, of course, yeah.
It's all very, very strong, independent women. So I'm always... this conversation always... I go, like, well, I can only speak for me in my life. I'm not really...
You've seen the progression of women.
Yeah, I think it's incredible. But also, I always worry sometimes the whole thing gets set back when we use sort of words traditional and things like to be, what was the expression you used a second ago, traditionally a good woman or something, I think.
It's an entrenched stereotype.
And it is.
I mean.
And I think it absolutely is.
All right, let me go to Storm. Storm.
Well, in the audience here, we've got Jodie, and you think men are getting a bit defensive, maybe?
I think slightly because of the extreme feminism that's been going on recently, they can feel quite targeted and almost labelled as something, so they can get quite defensive and maybe feel more competitive because of that. Possibly, which is
that's
interesting because that's like
how
women felt originally, that like they were labelled and
it's
targeted.
It's a new opponent for men, this, by the way, in the workplace. Men were always up against men. So if I've wanted your job, you've got the top job, and I thought, well, I'll have some of that, and I'll try and prove because I've got to try and beat you to get your job. But now I've suddenly got, I know what to do against you.
Yeah.
I don't know how to tackle
this. But that was always how it was for women. So
yeah,
men are just experiencing what it was for women.
This is not
Chris, we don't have much time. Let's just do a bit of social media.
Just a quick message. So Abigail says, it seems society has taken the stereotypes of feminism without actually knowing much about it at all. There are a lot of misconceptions. I think that is probably true.
Fascinating discussion. Our news review is coming. All the big stories in the papers and online, including Donald Trump claiming he's got magic about him after those midterm elections and his sex education a bit too squeamish. We will see you very soon.